Welcome to the Elders Street Synagogue, the largest independent historic restoration in this city, not connected to a large institution or a public body. Started in the mid-1980s, the rebirth of this historic house of worship evolved slowly and steadily in the same way that Jane Jacobs taught us long ago how neighborhoods and whole cities rejuvenate over time through the efforts of many individuals. 20 years, 20,000 supporters, $20 million or thereabout is approximately what it took. Fortunately, you are here on a sunny day. You are seeing the best of the stained glass windows at their most glorious. Jane actually followed the progress of this project through the reports that I would bring her on my visits to Toronto over many years. She loved that this preservation effort, now formerly a museum, embraced its Chinatown neighbors. And if you have never been to one of our egg rolls, egg cream, and empanada days, come this Sunday, June 19th, noon to 4. It is the most original, fun, and fascinating block party you will ever attend. Author and activist extraordinaire, Jane Jacobs' 7 books, starting with Death and Life of Great American Cities, changed the way the world views cities. And she helped us understand how the city is a fabric with all its parts, streets, parks, sidewalks, buildings, people, are intricately connected and interdependent. 2016 marks the centennial of Jacobs' birth, and we've organized this year-long series of lectures to revisit, explore, and honor her ideas. So tonight is the second of the series of lectures by notable writers, thinkers, and activists to honor and build on the legacy of Jane Jacobs and to renew a discussion about her ideas. These lectures are organized and sponsored by the Center for the Living City. 2 years before her death, the center was established with Jane's enthusiastic approval by a small group of urbanists expressly to build on her legacy. In the 10 years since, we have sent a young architect as a Jane Jacobs Fellow to New Orleans to help low-income homeowners figure out how to rebuild their homes after Katrina. We created a post-Katrina exhibit at the Museum of the City of New York and helped local people all over the world lead Jane Jacobs walks to observe their own communities. We published 3 books related to Jane's work and have now established this lecture series. When you walked in tonight, you were given a full schedule of the series and an envelope to enable you to support our efforts. The lectures are free, but we depend on the generosity of supporters to help us build on Jane's legacy. This series is what our executive director, Stephen Goldsmith, calls a trick. This is not just a celebration of Jane's ideas. This is an invitation to all of you to use these reflections to create responses to new challenges. Jane taught us how to observe, understand, and value the urban life around us. And here we are, in this glorious 1887 landmark, talking about Jane Jacobs, who famously said, quote, "Old ideas sometimes can use new buildings. New ideas must use old buildings," close quote. New ideas about parks and open space is what our speaker tonight has been about for several decades. Elizabeth Barlow Rogers is best known for her undaunting leadership in the rescue and restoration of Central Park. Some of you may be old enough to remember what a degraded, frightening place the park was. By establishing the Central Park Conservancy, by enlisting the involvement and support of citizens, and by holding government accountable in a new way, Betsy blazed a new trail of stewardship of public parks, followed by cities all over the country and the world. Her credits are many, including receiving the 2010 Jane Jacobs Medal for Lifetime Achievement and her establishment of the Foundation for Landscape Studies, whose mission is to promote an active understanding of the meaning of place in human life through support of landscape history scholarship. The foundation publishes a wonderful journal called Sightlines, some of which will be out front with the books. Most recently, Betsy has published a fascinating book called Green Metropolis, The Extraordinary Landscapes of New York City as Nature, History, and Design. Copies will be available for her to sign after the lecture. The book is an eye-opener for those of you who have no clue what varied landscapes there are to explore in this ultimate urban metropolis. From Inwood Park, Jamaica Bay, and right up to the High Line, the book is chock full of fascinating information. In all her work, Betsy, like so many other productive city activists, has been deeply influenced by Jane Jacobs. And Jane was a great admirer of Betsy's work. So it is my pleasure to introduce Betsy and to note that we will take questions and have discussion following her talk.
City planning, but master planning, we'll see. Her particular emphasis was, of course, the biggest master planner of them all, Robert Moses. And in New Haven, I could see that every footprint of that law, the master planner responsible for the makeover of a significant part of that city. And I learned that modernism, or modern, still modern in those days, didn't apply only to architecture. It was also a dominant theory.
Is it possible to up the mic?
And much as I admire then, admire now, the recently built Sigmund building on its raised platform, solitary splendor on the wall, the Corbusier's Ville Bonheur's was another man. Its super blocks detached from the richly textured fabric surrounding them were, as Jane forcefully maintained, a disaster in terms of life. Not only that, perhaps she was going to wipe out all of its appearance. To see her idea, Jane's idea, of a vibrant neighborhood of low-scale buildings with mixed uses, I even made a pilgrimage down from New Haven to Hudson Street in the West Village, just to know what she was You had strict zoning codes, separation of city into neighborhoods according to these land use plans. And I remember these color-coded maps showing industrial zones in purple, commercial centers called CBD, Central Business Districts, in red, and residential areas in yellow. And there were some areas in green on these maps, but they seemed to be the kind of low priority residual spaces rather than like the parks and squares that had been created in the laying out of cities such as Philadelphia and Savannah, or as armatures for further growth in the case of New York, Buffalo, and Boston in the days of Frederick Law Olmsted and Calvin Fox. In Professor Punnett's course on the history of cities, I learned about the British Garden City movement led by Ebenezer Howard, a utopian form of low-density urbanism in which people lived in close proximity both to one another and to nature. The Garden City planning philosophy was adopted in this country in the early years of the 20th century, and because my husband Ed was from Forest Hills Gardens, in Queens, which had been designed by Frederick Law Olmsted Jr., I had a firsthand experience of its relaxed, curvilinear circulation system, community house, and ubiquitous streetery. And then in the planning school, I learned about another planned community in Queens, Sunnyside Gardens, which grew out of an early 1920s planning discussion in which Lewis Mumford had an influential role, and we're about to get to Lewis and Jane. How many of you have visited Sunnyside? Each private residence has a small front garden facing the street and a private garden in the rear. There are also rental units in some of the two and three family houses, and these enjoy private terraces overlooking the gardens. But such visionary green, because of such visionary green amenities, Sunnyside is now on the National Register of Historic Places. I hate to say it, much as I admire Jane's brand of urbanism, I lean toward Mumford's view of the matter of neighborhoods like Sunnyside. There's a new biography of Jane coming out. Robert, you say Knievel was that? Canada. My editor had just given me a page of this until I read it the last couple of days. And it's a biography of Jane. He thinks that Mumford had a point to. And when he wrote in his scathing, overly contemptuous, and on the whole unfair review of death and life, that her simple formula does not suggest that her eyes have ever been hurt by ugly disorder of confusion, or ears offended by the roar of trucks smashing through once quiet residential neighborhoods, or her nose assaulted by the chronic odors of ill-ventilated, unsunned housing. Well, T goes a little far. But Canico points out that Jane really disliked Sunnyside. She really disliked planned communities. And she thought they were devoid of all vitality. And then Canico goes on to say, in holding up diversity and dynamism as supreme good, Jane simply couldn't see that her thinking was sadly myopic. Canico adds that Jane Jacobs simply couldn't see the ecological disaster of the modern city had become something that Mumford called willful blindness. Now, we can talk about all this later. But go on with these communities that really did interest me, communities like Sunnyside and then the Radburn in New Jersey, which is contemporary with Sunnyside and designed by Clarence Stein and Henry Wright, the same architects that designed Sunnyside. It's also on the National Register of Historic Places. And it was dubbed a city for the motor age. And its layout was based on the separation of vehicular and pedestrian traffic. And in Radburn, every house has access to walkways traversing broad stretches of communal green space so kids can run free and neighbors have privacy, but still not live in single lot isolation. Unlike Sunnyside, which was nestled within the urban fabric of Queens and Radburn, like FLO's Urban Homestead to Riverside outside of Chicago, these were meant to serve as an enlightened model of suburban design. And suburban is another word that gets pretty hot when we're talking about Jane. So Radburn's also, I said, on the National Register of Historic Places, and she really didn't have much to say good about that either, but I felt that there were both good and bad suburbs, and that some were not suburbs, planned communities, and that Reston, Virginia, which was on the drawing boards at the time I was in Yale, fell into the category of good, with the ideals of open space planning and a lifestyle in which human beings were meant to live in close association with nature. Attached housing, close community fabric, but within a framework of nature. Nevertheless, there was to be no suburban home for me. I truly wanted to live right in the center of the greatest city in the world, as I still do. And at the same time, I thought it equally important to be in contact with nature. Because of that, I discovered just how green a city New York is, in spite of the popular assumption that it's primarily a landscape, concrete, steel, glass, asphalt. So, with my master's degree in city planning, I could have gotten a job at the City Planning Commission, I guess, but I thought that would be rather bureaucratic and more attuned to the kind of master planning that I had come qualms about, rather than to Jane's principles of neighborhood preservation. In my case, the focus was on preserving the city's parks from further encroachments and saving its remaining wetlands. By this time, almost every available piece of the city's once extensive marshes had been converted into sanitary landfill, as it's called, and the Department of Sanitation, sanitary landfill sites, meaning garbage dumps. Robert Moses had been behind a great deal of this during his tenure as Parks Commissioner from 1934 to 1961. That's because making solid ground in half the garbage, decommissioned landfill site, cap the garbage, and then as it becomes solid, presumably, then it is covered with layers of soil and so forth. And this was parkland for Robert Moses, not ready-made parkland, but man-made parkland. Marine Park in Brooklyn is one example. There are lots of examples. Flushing Meadow Park in Queens, which, as you know, is the site of two World's Fairs, is a Moses Park. And it's hard, though, to say, we mustn't demonize Moses completely, because, and Bob Carroll's very fair, I think, in his book, because we see the autocratic side, we see the side that really did harm to the cities and their the texture and the life of the cities. But recreation, Olmstedian that I am, and as much as I love the notion of this romantic scenery, I mean, this is paramount in our underlying philosophy of restoring something. Nevertheless, the playgrounds equally receive the attention of the Conservancy. These are very important recreation facilities. Robert Moses wants tons of facilities. But those additions to the park system, some of them, those waterside parks, when you think of the marshes, and how they serve as spongy barriers and buffers against coastline destruction from hurricanes. It's like Sandy, you see me nodding at the river because she's been in New Orleans now after Katrina. We had Sandy here. And these are rich breeding grounds of all sorts of marine life, as well as buffers from hurricanes and storms. And so you have to deplore the fact that every single marsh, except for the smallest remnants of the city's wetlands, have now been obliterated. Fresh kills on Staten Island, the last remaining and largest of our once vast wetlands, was closed in 2000, and its capped mounds of old garbage are in the process now of becoming a city park. And that's a chapter in my book. As I discuss this part, which had its origin in Moses wrangling with the Department of Sanitation over the control of this 2,400-acre parcel of rich marine habitat, it will not be open to the public for 30 years after the methane gas trapped below the surface has been released. It will be a city park. But I'm just trying to reinforce my point about deploring the destruction of all New York City's wetlands. The question is, where do you... I think it's been shipped down to old strip mine sites in Pennsylvania. I don't really know, but I'm saying that it is a great problem, but dumping it on the marshes and ruining them is a shame. Activism as a volunteer with a small civic group called the Parks Association, now known as New Yorkers for Parks, gave me my first taste of how citizens could enter a relationship with city government through a combination of advocacy and protest. Although he was out of office by the time I wrote Moses a letter protesting highway building along the city's waterfront, he's within the week. He was very prompt with this correspondence. Within the week, he was then in his office in the Far Board the Bridge Authority, and I got this letter sharply applied to me that his parks were built, that parks were built in tandem an example being East River Park, which came into being with FD McGrath. So I wasn't sufficiently feisty to point out, as Jane would have, how difficult it was to have several walks in either way, you know, before you find an elevated walkway, an elevated crossing to get to it. And it's worth not. But let's leave that alone. Interestingly, at the same time that Jane was spearheading the campaign to bring the construction of the Lower Manhattan Expressway to a halt, I was marching with the Staten Island Citizens Planning Committee to protest the proposed route of the Richmond Parkway, another Moses Highway, which was planned to go along the central wooded spine of Staten Island. Brad Green, a landscape architect and resident of Staten Island, who had formerly been employed in the building of, this is another planned community like Weston, Greenbelt, Maryland. He coined the name of Staten Island Greenbelt for the 4.8-mile north-south ridge running most of the length of the island. Fortunately, the group of Staten Island citizens leading the fight against the highway won. And look on a parks map today and you'll see that the Staten Island Greenbelt comprises Reed's Basket, Willow Swamp, Willow Brook, and High Rock Parks, along with William T. Davis Wildlife Refuge. As in the case of Jane's triumph over Moses in the battle over the construction of the Lower Manhattan Expressway, saving the Staten Island Greenbelt was a great victory. It is one of the city's most extraordinary natural landscapes, and you'll find a chapter devoted to High Rock Park in my book, Green and Bottles. My other experiences as a park activist in the 1960s, when I went on field trips to places like Jamaica Bay, which is next to JFK Airport, Inwood Hill Park at the northern tip of Manhattan, and Pelham Bay Park in the East Bronx, providing impetus for writing my first book, The Forest and Wetlands of New York City. I think my new book has something like The Forest and Wetlands of New York City Redux, since it was born out of desire to revisit the areas I've written about in the earlier book. At the same time, I wanted to examine some of the more interesting additions and changes to Green New York during the past 45 years. Getting those decades again, I do roll by your kids. I originally thought I would title my book Beyond the End of the Line, since almost all the parks I write about are at the end of subway lines. I realized that this sounded like too much of a downer, and so I chose Green Metropolis, which I think is a better title anyway. And this book is not really meant to be a guidebook. But if you're inclined to use it that way, you will find in the back transportation, public transportation directions to every one of the parks that I'll discuss in the book. My next book was Frederick Law Olmsted's New York, published in 1972, a year after The Forest and Wetlands, because I think you mentioned something about the dire condition of Olmsted's great masterpiece. It became the catalyst. It was just so disgusting and so sad. And you knew about Olmsted, and if you appreciated the greensward plan, the design that he and his partner Kelvin Fox conceived for Central Park, you really had to just weep. And I became the leader of a small volunteer organization called the Central Park Task Force. And then after Ed Hodges' election as mayor, the Parks Commissioner, Gordon Davis, saw what I was doing, lighting my little candle in the darkness of the mess that we had made of the city and of the park. And Gordon brought me into city government and gave me a title of administrator. We created this title, Central Park Administrator. I got the title, but no budget. In the midst of the fiscal crisis. And because I had, it's just like the money that you raise in this extraordinary building. You start out and you never think that it's going to happen. But then, little by little, you find that people care and they care for you. And so, the Central Park Conservancy, we created our first board, and then I went on for several years. We had to have a management. We never called it a master plan. See, we call it a management and restoration plan. And we spent 3 years between 82 and 85 developing this plan. And it is the first time since 1888 that the park had been looked at it in its entirety. So we took the Green Tour plan, took the contemporary park as it was, and we mapped the whole circulation system. We did a user study, we did a tree count, we really got the basic shape of what we wanted to do, and the programmatic aspect, that important word management, and developed tree crews, turf crews, planting crews, wildlife conservation crew, graffiti removal crew. Mm-hmm. Think of 50,000 square feet of graffiti. The park was like a graffiti billboard. And then the people started coming back. I mean, they were always in the park, but the park became a much nicer place. And it is that management and restoration plan that is still behind everything that goes on. Not followed to the letter, but in the spirit, which is the great thing. Okay, so I'll talk more about James and my ideas about urban life. There's a difference, though certainly not a dichotomy, between our outlooks on what makes cities great. Rereading Death and Life of Great American Cities when I was preparing to come here tonight, I felt like I was in a time machine, traveling back half a century. I was struck by the fact that New York City was an entirely, is an entirely different place now than it was when Mother Jacobs, when Walter's unkind and sexist and impotent, analyzed the ways in which authoritarian master planning was destroying what Roberta calls messy vitality. In other words, James' concept of sound neighborhood. It's important to emphasize here that Jane was, as I am too, a product of the 1950s. Neither of us could have imagined the tsunami-sized wave of social change that was about to engulf the greatest of great American cities. At the time she wrote her book in 1961, John Lindsay was a United States congressman, soon to be elected mayor of New York. As the 60s youth culture reacted to the parents' generation, the decorum of society dissolved, and New York City became a very different and more populous place from what it had been in the 50s. As racial and civil unrest engulfed America, Lindsay was successful in avoiding potential rioting, such as was occurring in Newark and Detroit. Lauded for walking the streets of Harlem in the turbulent days of 1968, following the death of Martin Luther King, he brought a new set of liberal values to this city. The Lindsay administration also brought a new approach to city planning. The talented young architects who prepared a master plan for the entire five borough city, something the city had never done, were different from those of the old Moses-dominated regime. It is interesting to me that Jane actually approved of their plan for Battery Park City and felt the same way as the Urban Land Institute, who called Battery Park City a model of successful large-scale planning efforts and marketing a positive shift away from the urban renewal mindset of the time. Berta's scribbling something down. She's going to tell us. We're in the question and answer period. Whether I got that right or not. Okay. At the same time this was going on, Lindsay was encountering huge labor issues as one after another arm of city government, transit workers, teachers, sanitation workers, and other civil service employees, including those who operated the city's drawbridges and sewage treatments, went on strike. By the time Lindsay left office, the city was lurching toward economic disaster, and his successor, Abraham Bean, was left to deal with the resulting fiscal crisis. Corporations moved to greener pastures, and residential parts of the city changed as slumlords. This had really been going on all through the 60s, but they changed. Slumlords inherited neighborhoods where the flight of the middle class had turned their abandoned apartments over to impoverished African-American and Puerto Rican migrants. With unpaid municipal real estate taxes and a total lack of maintenance, even those residents left. In the South Bronx, there were many vacant buildings that just went up in flames due to arson, leaving vast, I don't know whether who remembers, vast swaths of rubble to be carted away. And remember when Harlem was also a Bible for danger. Crime was rampant, drugs ubiquitous, and robberies and muggings routine. And it wasn't just the poor neighborhoods like Harlem that suffered. Throughout the city, there were garbage-strewn streets, and walking down the sidewalks was a very malodorous experience because of the curbside dog poop. The air was filthy with the cinders, garbage incinerators, and the parks. If you don't remember, you can certainly imagine, as I mentioned, Central Park was nothing more than a giant graffiti billboard with bare dirt and instead of grassy lawns. Who was I to act the role of Pollyanna and think that Central Park should remain a city park instead of being turned over to the federal government? Why not adopt the suggestion of some people that the state operated now that the city was practically broken? I'm sure that Jane, the paramount champion of local autonomy, would have disapproved of these last gasp strategies as much as I did. This is when I decided to take off my advocacy hat and stop begging for more funds for parks in the dwindling city budget. No more scolding of government officials. It was time to try to work from inside rather than outside the parks department. It was also time to ignore private citizens who said, we're taxpayers after all, and the parks are a city responsibility. I heard that a lot. In spite of its danger and decrepitude, Central Park was still used and still loved because of what it had always been in the life of the city. Its creation had been inspired by citizens. Why couldn't a partnership between citizens and government come to the rescue? Fortunately, as you know, this is what happened, and the park's resurrection had an effect on the other parks in the city, and the parks department became less demoralized and encouraged other private groups to form conservancies. And I think you mentioned it's become a model for other cities throughout the country. And of course, people always want to know everybody thinks money. It's simply people, not just its users who care about it, but the people, as here, who are large and small donors who appreciate the value of parks as cornerstones of urban health. From the beginning, Central Park was a purpose-built people's park, and it was saved by people, which gives large and small enabled a series of restoration projects and new management protocols. All this flows out of the management and restoration plan I just mentioned. This is the place I think to mention that in large measure the saving of Central Park was due to Jewish work. You just look at the roster of conservancy donors and you can see that from its very beginning, it was the generosity of Jews who wanted to give back something to the city that had embraced them and where they had made their fortunes. This is basically what made the park's turnaround possible. Some people think of the Conservancy as an elitist organization. This anti-rich people, Jew or Gentile, anti-rich people attitude ignores the fact that Central Park is a people's park as much as ever, and the fact that the Conservancy is supported by people of all income levels. What else happened, not only in Central Park, but also to the other parks in New York City? Again, I would like to both agree with and take issue with Jane when she points out in Chapter 5 of Death and Life that parks are volatile places. They tend to run to the extreme of popularity and unpopularity. They can be delightful features of city districts and economic assets to the surroundings as well, but pitifully few. They can grow more beloved and valuable with the years, but pitifully few show staying power. And this probably was true when she wrote these words, but it's now commonly recognized that parks do confer an economic boon on surrounding areas. And just think of the High Line, and that's also a chapter in my book, the story behind the High Line, behind the creation of the High Line. The architectural critics have written enough. I've written about the design of it too, of course, in my book, but it really is what these two remarkable men, Robert Hammond and Joss Davis, how they did. And if you want to talk about staying power, consider the army of volunteers who feel that it is a privilege to be park gardeners. Sheridan Square in the garden on the site of the former Women's House of Detention next to the historic Jefferson Market Courthouse are examples not far from where Jane once lived. Look also at the passion with which community gardeners throughout the city defend the vacant lots they have claimed and made into beds of vegetables and flowers and sites for artistic expression and burdening us. Moreover, Central Park would not look the way it does today without approximately 300 volunteers who work under the supervision of the Conservancy Zone Gardeners. That's a regular volunteers. Volunteers come in on an ad hoc basis, too. This certainly represents a tremendous transition from the kind of park users Jane describes. In her day, these folks were simply the recipients of a city planner's paradigm for a park, which was located according to the notion that open space is inherently a good thing. They were built, therefore, without consideration of context. Good context for Jane was a good mix of park users, pedestrian commuters on their way to and from work, mothers and pops at play in the mid-morning, and this was really before we had full-time working mothers, and staff from nearby offices and on their lunch break, older children in the afternoon after school. Bad context meant the kinds of neighborhoods. It used to be called Skid Row. I guess the Bowery down here, not far from it, it's called Skid Row, where many of the regular park users were homeless indigent loners. Nor did such creepy parks have to be in areas associated just with gang members, according to Jane. Because of their surroundings, they repelled a good social mix. But she maintained that commercial districts were also places that ordinarily didn't promote health and park use. And here we have a great example. Bryant Park in Midtown Manhattan used to be this kind of park, located on 42nd Street, right in the middle of Manhattan. It was a somewhat sinister, shadowy haven for druggies and drugs, but it didn't stay that way. At this point, I'd like to welcome Holly White into this conversation. Holly was revered for his populist attitude towards cities almost as much as Jane, and his prescriptive writings about things that count most in good park making have now been widely accepted. At Bryant Park, a brilliant redesign incorporating Holly's public space sociology regarding such things as open view lines, clean bathrooms, and a flexible seating arrangement by means of movable chairs made a huge difference. Ongoing high-level maintenance beyond what the city could provide was ensured by the creation of the Bryant Park BID, Business Improvement District, that operates in the same fashion as a Civic Park Conservancy under a management contract with the city. The only difference here is the fact that its revenues come in the form of assessments on nearby buildings rather than exclusively from voluntary contributions. I have a final reservation about Jane's philosophy of what constitutes a good part. Things, not managing it, but leading it some of the, the insects, the birds, the insects, the dead birds, the insects. And, but it's all done in a way that just looks incredibly natural. There, of course, is where you see a million birds. And if you don't know this before, the Ramble's a prime stopover and refueling station for all sorts of migratory species and a nesting area for many native birds. So it's a chapter in my book. Most of the extraordinary landscapes I discuss make up a relatively small visitor count with the quiet delight they offer for experiencing the marvels of nature. Let's not forget that we share the city not only with other people, but with a host of wildlife species ranging from mating horseshoe crabs in Jamaica Bay to visiting wild turkeys in Battery Park in the Ramble to the occasional coyote in Van Cortlandt Park. And some of our parks are even in some. These are just a few of the more unusual species that call New York City home. Let's therefore not forget that parks also have important non-human residents for us. During the Bloomberg administration, over 800 acres were added to the New York City park system. While old parks were being restored, new ones, including the Brooklyn Bridge Park, the High Line, and several parks along the Bronx River, were being created. And I would like to believe that Jane would approve of this current trend toward an environmentally richer, more livable city. I'd like to think that tonight we're not only celebrating her great influence and our understanding of the nature of cities, but also the nature within them, and the fact that right now New York City is enjoying a green golden age. Thank you.
Moses also, Mofford, also hated the fact that Jane's book did not celebrate him. His scathing review of her book, Scathing Mother Jacob's Home Remedies, was the title. It's a whole other conversation, but it's a very important distinction. Streetcar suburbs versus highways and density and not. But I also wanted to note that I was fascinated by the letter you got from him that said parks were in tandem with highways, which I always felt he cared more about the highways than the parks. The parks were a way to build with highways, but I never, and I mean, your letter confirms that.
Oh,
and really amazing.
He wanted to make it. Highways are ribboned with parks.
Is that Moses?
Moses, right.
Leave
Moses out.
Let's stop.
But I think
we can go on this one.
But I also wanted to, in terms of Jane and Battery Park City, I wanted to add to the fact that she did admire Battery Park City because it was the first of the new developments that was planned on a grid to connect with or at least extend the city as opposed to a suburban kind of, you know, cul-de-sac development. And
I have a little ritual.
Oh, good.
Okay. Our map, since you brought that up, I didn't really think that we ought to get into Westwood because after the war of the Manhattan Expressway, nobody was going to let a highway, come back in another highway into the city, defeating Robert Moses. plywood buildings was what it was all about. And also, you know, there was the environmental movement, you know, which became a way of killing it. But I wasn't really promoting it at the time. And then if you've read, you know, the essayist Philip Lopez, really wonderful essayist. Philip told us, well, that's not fight here. I'm sorry, I shouldn't have lied. But in other words, you want to knit back to the city completely instead of having this highway that's masquerading as a boulevard where you take your life in your hands. It's really lovely, the parks, everything they're doing, all of the Hudson River. I don't have any beef with that. But it would have been really knit right back to the city if the highway had been already under and gone along the percentage, you know, without invisible. Thank you.
Well, which is the largest wind park developed in the city, and quite wonderful, even though the High Line gets all the attention. The Hudson River Park is just fabulous. And what's interesting about the Hudson River Park is it serves many different communities, and they were all part of the planning of three different sections. So they reflect more their community than most parks do. It's sort of been overshadowed by the High Line, but it's an extraordinary, it's a waterfront park, and it has its areas of real nature as well as recreation. So I just wanted to add that to your wonderful list of new parks and Brooklyn Bridge, which you mentioned.
Sure. Before the question, in terms of Hudson River Park, all those bicyclists are riding right along with all the fumes from all the drivers, and I don't know how wise that is. But what I want to say has nothing to do with that. It's good to see you, Betsy. I've been a volunteer in Central Park for almost 30 years now. But I would like to know what you and what Jane Jacobs and what Lewis Munger would think of what's going on in the city today, where the buildings, I haven't lived on 57th Street, but down the street from me, I've got 90-story buildings that are casting a shadow on encroachment in Central Park up to 72nd Street in the winter months. I've gone to all the community boards. I wish you were on the planning commission because it makes no minimum. Now they're planning a 90-story building, Sutton and 58. It's mid-block. The home is doing an 83-story building.
I couldn't agree with you. Well, I can't agree with you more that, you know, New York, it's wonderful. It's always changed scale. And then think of how we celebrate, you know, skyscrapers, Chrysler Building, Empire State, and that's the city we love. These are abominations, these things. And then there are people from the Arab Emirates or people that are laundering money. I don't know. I mean, they're, you know, who buys a $90 million apartment?
Two-thirds of the apartments in Time Warner are owned by Shell Corporation.
Exactly.
They're using the buildings for piggy banks to launder money.
Well, I mean, we're totally on the same page there. And I think, do you think Jane would have an answer to that? Yes.
No, I don't think Jane would have an answer because she never had an answer to things that were, you know, she was not familiar. But I think she would be appalled, as she was when some of this was beginning, that none of what's happening today has anything to do with anything we've ever seen. The global money, the fact is, the worst thing that ever happened is they started regulating Swiss bank accounts, because instead of Swiss bank accounts, they now buy apartments. And this is, you know, global money in a way that is totally destructive. However, the city is allowing this. So if Jane were to say anything, I would predict she would say, so what is the city doing about it? But we are at a time where the global money is having an enormous impact on everything. There are people who complain, oh, Greenwich Village, you know, if it weren't for Jane, it wouldn't be gentrified. Well, okay, the fact is, there isn't a city or a neighborhood in this country that is not feeling the imbalance if you're having, this is the impact on our cities that we've never seen in the way that we're seeing today. And so it's very hard to measure today based on a lot of the things that we've been talking about, because the first and only thing that you're really talking about is the 90%, that 99%, 1% in global money, and that's having an extraordinary.
And Roberta, can I actually, I'm going to take advantage that I'm holding the mic. An example that I can think of also to answer your question. I don't know if you've been to IKEA in Red Hook, but right across from it, there's Added Value Farm. And that's an example of a public place. I'm not sure if the city owns the lot, but it's been turned into a green space where they have work education programs, largely serving some of the youth from 16 to 24 living in the projects, in the housing developments down in Red Hook. But then they're also working with York Cares, bringing in volunteers from all over the city. And they are now having a farmer's market, which caters to people both in the neighborhood and outside of the neighborhood. And businesses like Etsy drop their compost off there, and they do a community compost project that's partially run through the city and other green markets, like I know the compost or the scraps from the Grand Army Plaza Green Market go there. So that could be an example of not, I don't know if it's the space that's making it work, but it is partially the Parks Department working within the space to attempt to bring different communities together. So that's a very cool green space as well.
This is great that you brought this up. It really is great. But you see, it's another example. We talk about city, we talk about government. Jenny, you know, talked about city officials very harshly, and because that's not really been done. You need permissions, you need all sorts of things, but it's all that wonderful energy. It's the local food movement, it's the green rooftops, people are gardening, you know, on their rooftops. There's so much imagination, you know, these microbreweries, there's just lots of things. And I think the community gardens, you see that when I was trying to make that distinction between the world of the 1950s and the world now, there are bad things that have happened, like the great, you know, skyscrapers that we love to hate, but it's also a lot of really good things, and you've just touched on them, I think. But it's all imagination and energy. I mean, there's just such a great supply of it right here. And it is focused on nature and on health and all those good things as well. There are lots of beekeepers.
The interesting additional thought on things like all the creative park and garden uses, all the stories of the High Line, the stories of Betsy and Central Park, the stories of all these neighborhood rebuilding efforts, they all started locally. These are Jacobsian projects in the best way. Some of them started based on a fight against a project and then blossomed into something positive, because as Betsy so well described, it took people and volunteers and people who cared about Central Park to be part of it, and that was a major shift. But anything, always go to the root of the question of how it started, and what's so amazing is that these things often started in a very Jane Jacobs way.
When people ask me, they always say, what does it take, you know, for the Conservancy and to get born? And I say, well, first the vision. You really have to have the vision. And then you have to have a good board, as you know, a supportive board. You have to have the plan. We talked about management restoration plan. And then you have to have the zealous nut.
I know. We share that. She did that in Central Park, and I did that here. Somehow, there were plenty of times when I woke up in the morning and said, am I nuts? And I'd say, yes. But one step in front of the other. Wait a minute. Wait till the mic comes to you.
The two factors we really have to address, one, our air rights and the transfer thereof. That air rights. And the transfer thereof. If we didn't allow the way we do it, we wouldn't have these big high rises. And second, the 421 tax advantage. For example, that building, some of these big high-rise buildings, they're not going to be paying taxes for 20 years. And some of those big apartments are selling for $90 million. I forget, if they were to pay the normal taxes, property taxes, on an apartment, it was $200,000 or $300,000 a year. They're only paying like $89,000 because of the 421. So they have entitled these wealthy people these tremendous benefits. And that's one way very quickly shut down some of these problems.
That's what I meant by the will to do it. We don't have.
Well, we have to develop the will, and people have to get it, you know.
Well, there's a lot, you know, there are people fighting all over the city, but.
This goes technically from City Hall.
Well, unfortunately, the leadership from City Hall endorses all of this.
Sure, he's using the excuse of affordable housing to go high.
Let's try to get back on Bessie's. Where's the come around?
I'm
the Highland.
No, Central Park. The Highland has to do a lot more than narrow.
She's
real.
I know that in terms of being crowded. You're talking about Central Park,
right?
Being crowded.
Yeah.
Well, I think
it takes away its beauty on the weekends. It's not nurturing. It's not the nature that Olmsted and Watts talked about. And it's teeming with people. And I'm not really so sure that more is better. But that's personal.
Well, but let me say this, not just because I'm being defensive about Central Park. The reason I brought up the Highland is that people are really compressed and really have a lot of vitality, but it seems to me it's getting a little crowded. But Central Park has 840 acres. And I don't know whether you've been up in the North End and walked in the ravine on a long weekend. I don't know, whether you've gone to the Dana Center, walked around the Harlem Mirror. I don't know whether you've sat on a quiet bench in the Conservatory Garden. I think that actually what I like, I mentioned that, yes, vitality and all of that that Jane is promoting, sure, I'm for that, but also for the quiet areas as well. We even have quiet zones, more quiet zones. But the vibrancy, I think of Central Park when I'm around Bethesda Terrace and the mall on a weekend. I think, gosh, it's just the best theater. So, I mean, that's my feeling. But then I really do love going up and, feeling I'm really in the woods, up in the Ramble or in the North.
Or in a park or one of the other parks in the city.
But you said specifically,
huh? I know, Central. I agree. I live there. Okay. I see it. So, the city is crowded. The city government worships our tourism. Sometimes our tourism is interfering with those of us who live here. That's just another issue. But there's no doubt it's crowded. Next question.
Yeah.
Over here. While you're here.
Hi, I'm quite new to New York and I moved here a couple months ago.
Say that again.
I'm new to New York and moved here a couple of months ago.
Oh, what are you?
Thank you. I'm in love with the city, I love Central Park, I love the parks around the water, the Hudson River, and lately I've been thinking about ways of adding the park to Manhattan, but there's obviously not that much empty space anymore. So I've been thinking quite a lot about the ideas of having Dwarf Garden, so parks on the buildings. And actually going back to what we were talking before about the air rights, a lot of buildings have sold their air rights and they can't really build up anymore, but you could build a park on it. So what do you think about the idea of getting together developers or owners of the buildings that are a similar height that have sold their air rights to push for a movement to build a park in the sky?
Well, I'm all for it, and all we mentioned by the organization, the Foundation for Landscape Studies, do, by the way, pick up our sight lines in the back of the room, I think it's in the back, as you go out. But our chairman of the board, his name is Frederick Rich, and Fred has an apartment down overlooking Battery Park, and it's in a Leeds building, so the building is old, and it is tall about, that. And he has a rooftop garden, and he works with Danny Novak, who's a great local food guru, and has food guru. I'm looking at Lisa to help out. But anyway, the local food movement, you can have dinner on Fred's rooftop garden, and it will have been grown 3 feet from where you're sitting there. And so, yes, I'm totally with you on that.
Somebody. Oh, over there. And I think this will be your last question. I want to remind you all that Betsy's books are available in the back. She will sign them. And we have copies of some of Jane's books as well. So, your question.
Yes.
First of all, Betsy, thank you so much for your contributions to New York and to the field. So I want to go back to what you spoke about, the tension about giving private money to parks versus the city's responsibility. And this is something that's come up. I used to work in the budget office of the Parks Department, so I'm very aware of the limitations of the parks budget and appreciative of CPC and other nonprofits. I'm now in a place where I'm trying to raise money, private money, for Prospect Park and other parks. And I get pushback from my friends who I really respect that say that they feel uncomfortable with that because it should be the city's responsibility, and that us giving money is taking, letting the city off the hook in a sense, and will eventually shift the budget away from parks. So how would you respond while the city's in a very different place than it was when you began your work?
Well, that argument really was made from the beginning. I think I alluded to that. We're taxpayers. The city's responsibility is to take care of the parks. Well, the city's budget is going to be cut, and it's going to be cut anyway. And what is the first part of the city budget to be cut? But also, it's not just money. It really, city money. It is about that private will and private energy, and it's partnering with the city. When the largest gift, well, now the most amazing gift, which is to restore the woodlands in Central Park, was, I mentioned the generosity of Jews, philanthropy that has done so much to restore. The latest gift was $100 million, and that's directed toward the woodlands of Central Park. I'm getting myself off track here. Way in which people can inspire city government are other major government, Richard Gilder. When I went to him, my husband Ted is a marathon runner, and most of the people said to me on my board and other people, look, you've done enough. Just stop it. You've done some projects in the north, and you've done the Bethesda Terrace, just manage what you have. And I was sitting there on the great lawn, which was the great dust bowl, waiting for Ted, who had just finished the New York City Marathon. And I thought, this can't be. So I went to see Dick Gilder, who was another one of these enormously generous philanthropists in New York City. And he said, how much will it take? And I said, it has to be all those West Side projects. The West Side, you remember, you lived there. It was just a tangle of weeds and overgrowth, and it was very bad. And the great lawn, I said, $50 million. He said, okay, I will give you one third. You'll have to raise another third, and you'll have to get the city to give a third. So it was a deal. And it was that deal with the city, but the leverage was the money.
I just want to add, it just so happens coincidentally between last night, where I happened to see Parks Commissioner at an event, and
silver. And today, at a lunch, I heard speak to someone who works in the Parks Department. I was delighted to hear, A, the Parks Department budget has just been increased by $50 million. And some of the projects that I heard talked about today by Rick Bell, no one is writing about. If I was still a reporter, I would say it's a good story. But they're not the big places. There are a lot of small, local, and not yet attention-getting. But they are out there. They're out in the boroughs. This mayor, for all my criticism of him on the development side, at least in this department, seems to be paying attention to the places that have been forgotten. And they're smaller, and they take maybe less money, but there is city money going into a lot of community parks around the city. And that's good news, because one of the things about when we think of the crowds in Central Park is the need for more of the parks all around the city to take some of the pressure off it. One of the wonderful things about Betsy's book, if I can give it a little promote. There are these extraordinary places in the city that no one really thinks about going to. And I, for one, I used to bike around Central Park. I can't bike on the weekend. It scares me to death. So I think you're right, but what we have to be thinking more about is where else, instead of going to the same places. But unfortunately or fortunately, the city is overrun with people. And they're going to all the best places. And have you tried to take a local bus home from the theater? Instead they're all the suburban tourist buses. We're overrun. So these are problems that aren't easy, but there's a large city out there. It's not all Manhattan. There was a day when I was a reporter writing about things in Brooklyn, and I used to have to say to people, there is a bridge to Brooklyn. You couldn't get people, including my mother, who was born and raised there, I couldn't get her to come to Flatbush to see what was happening there. Now, we are increasingly a five-borough city, and this is good, because the energy is spreading out instead of being concentrated in one place. For better or worse. Would you like to?
I've got my special green pen, and I'm going to sit in the back of me. Oh, I hope somebody buys my book. Anyway,
so with that, I thank you all for coming.